Hi, folks. Ryan Honeyman here from Lyft Economy. Many folks have come to us over the last 10 years and asked, how do I get more involved in creating an economy that works for the benefit of all life? They also ask, what skills and experiences do I need to help make this transition? So 3 years ago, we created something called the Next Economy MBA to help address this and similar questions. Lyft Economy's Next Economy MBA is an online course that's designed for entrepreneurs, aspiring entrepreneurs, students, recent graduates, employees, and folks who want to learn more about transformational next economy strategies and businesses. Join the growing alumni network of nearly 250 alumni who've gone through this program and learned essential skills and hopefully built lifelong relationships for catalyzing businesses in the emergent and regenerative economy. So we encourage you to check out our course. You can go to lifteconomy.com/MBA. The next course, Cohort 7, starts on September 21st, 2021. So once again, go to www.lifteconomy.com/MBA. And now, on with the show. Welcome to Next Economy Now. The goal of this podcast series is to highlight the leaders who are taking a regenerative, bioregional, equitable, democratic, racially just, and whole systems approach to creating the new economy.
Sasha, welcome to the show.
Thanks so much, Erin. It's a pleasure to be here.
So tell our listeners a little bit about what you do and maybe starting with what's most exciting to you right now.
Sure. I'm happy to. And I'm in the very lucky position of almost always being excited about my work, sometimes in a panicked way and sometimes in a very enthusiastic and positive way. But it is certainly work that keeps me on my toes. So I am the co-founder and executive director of a nonprofit organization called SOIL, which stands for Sustainable Organic Integrated Livelihoods. And we've been working in Haiti since 2006, trying to develop sustainable sanitation solutions. And when I say sustainable, I mean from a social, environmental, and financial perspective. So over those 10 years, we've gone down a lot of different roads, some that have worked better than others. And I think that what we're really excited about right now is that this program that you mentioned called Eco Lakai, which is a household toilet program for dense urban areas. And I think there are a couple of things that are really exciting about it. One is that in Haiti right now, 99% of the waste that's produced by humans is not actually being treated. And with the Eco Lakai system, we actually collect all the waste and then are able to transform that into compost that can be used in agriculture. So I think I'm an ecologist. And for me, that's probably the most exciting part about what we do is being able to take something that has always been a public health problem and really transform it into an environmental solution. And then I think the second component that's really exciting is that because we're transforming a waste into a resource, we really saw an opportunity here to create livelihood opportunities in the sanitation sector. So instead of using a very traditional humanitarian aid approach, which was how we started our work in 2006, we're now working to build a sustainable financial model for this, whereby there's some combination of private sector opportunities and also public sector contributions. So I can talk more about that, but I'm an ecologist who is trying desperately to learn more about economics.
Thank you for that. I am really curious to hear more, especially from your perspective. You mentioned coming in with more of a traditional humanitarian approach and now looking at more of a economic development, if you will, approach, or a next economy economic development to take it one step further. Tell us a little bit about some of the learnings that you've had around that journey.
Oh yeah, it has been quite a learning journey for us. And so when we started in 2006, We had really come into the sector thinking very much from an ecological perspective. So we were already thinking about how could we convert human waste into a valuable resource. But because we understandably wanted to find a way to use the limited resources we had to reach the most people possible, we started looking at public toilets. And we were so small at the time, we would essentially get requests from communities that they needed a public toilet. And then we'd go out and we'd raise the money from individual supporters to build it. And we'd do a sort of course of education on how to maintain the toilet. And then we would pass it over to the community organizations for them to manage the toilet. And, you know, on the surface, this seemed like a great idea. We were mobilizing donor money to provide this infrastructure, and then the ongoing maintenance would be provided voluntarily. But I think the largest lesson for me, and I am not the first to learn this, and sadly, I'm sure I will not be the last, but I think there's a feeling within the development sector that the greater the need, the higher the level of volunteerism will be. And what I learned and now understand very well is that the greater people's needs are, the less able they are to volunteer. And you know, being able to volunteer is really a luxury that comes from having your basic needs met. So right. What we found with these public toilets was that, you know, they would work for 4 or 5 months, sometimes up to a year, but eventually they all started to fall into disrepair. And as I look back on it, I feel very naive in the sense that you can imagine, I mean, a public toilet anywhere in the world where you don't pay someone to manage that toilet is going to be disgusting in no time. I mean, the fact that they even remained running for a little while, I think was a real testament to the commitment of the communities we were working in. But in the end, people had to find a way to feed their families, and they couldn't spend time cleaning up someone else's waste. So we realized that really across the sanitation sector, this is a problem, this assumption that you put in the infrastructure and then somehow the maintenance will take care of itself or someone else will take care of it. And so we realized really the hardest thing is how do you maintain something like a toilet in the long term? And it seemed like the only way to do that was to have someone paid to do that work because it's hard work. So that was what shifted our thinking from this traditional humanitarian approach to really thinking about how can we create an aspirational product that would be worthwhile for people to pay an affordable ongoing fee for, and that service fee would then go to cover the salary of the people doing the work to maintain the toilets. So we started in about 2009 thinking about this approach, and then in 2010 the earthquake happened in Haiti, and we ended up spending about 3 years really doing emergency response after the earthquake, and came back to this, started coming back to it in 2012. So it's a program that's been around for about 4 years now. We've been developing it, and we now have over 1,000 families that are paying for this service on a monthly basis, and we're still working on the financial model. We haven't gotten to a point where these service fees actually cover the entire cost of toilet maintenance and waste treatment and production of compost. But I think we've made some great strides. And the fact that we've developed a household toilet product that people do feel like is worth paying a small monthly fee for feels like a big step in and of itself.
So the business model is effectively the product is the service of having access to a toilet. Is there any other co-product, for example, soil for farmers?
Yeah, so we have two sources of revenue in the business model. And basically the way the system works is that the toilet itself is this small portable toilet that just has a 5-gallon bucket for the waste, and we provide flushing material every week. So that's just some sort of dried agricultural waste, which replaces water and covers up the waste so it doesn't smell and you don't get problems with flies. And so basically people rent these toilets, they put them somewhere inside or outside their home. And then, so each week we collect the buckets, we take them to the composting facility, and there we compost them. It takes about 6 months for the process. And at the end of that, we have this beautiful compost, which we do sell to the agricultural sector, and then that generates a second stream of revenue to help recover some of the costs.
Perfect. So I want to bounce back to the business model in a little while, but first, you mentioned this period where you were doing sort of emergency response, and I want you to explain to our listeners why is composting human waste an important solution, especially in the age of increasing climate disasters like Hurricane Harvey and some of the unpredictable weather events that we're seeing?
Yeah, well, I'd be happy to talk about that. And I think that it is extremely timely in the sense that right as we speak, right now, Hurricane Irma is just starting to hit the north coast of Haiti, where we have the majority of our operations. So as I'm speaking with you, I'm also sort of watching the radar and trying to keep an eye on my phone in case anything should come up with our team there. So I think this question about providing safe treatment of waste and particularly treatment of waste that generates an ecological resource is a particularly important question at this moment in history and at this very moment in Haiti. So one of the reasons that Haiti has been so susceptible to these natural disasters that are becoming even more frequent as time goes by is that the environment has been so degraded. So the fact that there has been extensive deforestation in Haiti means that the mountainsides no longer have the soil that they need to hold the trees on and hold all that soil on. So every time you get these natural disasters, the soil just runs off the mountains, causes terrible mudslides and flooding, and then in the long term has the result of leaving very bare mountains that can't support agriculture or forestry growth. So I think that our work was very much motivated by the idea that one of the most pressing problems in Haiti and becoming more so all around the world is soil fertility. And really not only having the nutrients that you need that you can get from chemical fertilizers, but actually having that layer of soil there that protects people, protects urban areas from flooding, from mudslides, from all of these other effects of natural disasters that we're seeing around the world.
Can you tell us a little bit about the negotiation of having a humanitarian, nonprofit, for-profit hybrid come in and fulfill what ordinarily we would think of as being a public service or a government-provided service, or you know, sewage facilities are traditionally fall in the domain of civil society? Can you talk a little bit about that dynamic and how you've been negotiating that in the context of Haiti?
Oh yeah, well that's a great question, Erin, and I think that's something that we think about all the time. I think one of the very tricky things about trying to create business models and livelihood opportunities out of something like sanitation is the fact that basic sanitation should be a human right. And so how do you actually monetize something when you believe that it's a human right to have access to that? And because it's a basic human right, it has traditionally been seen as a public service. And not only because of the fact that it is a basic human right, but because the impacts of having poor sanitation extend far beyond the individual. So one of the things you see in Haiti and many parts of the world is that because until recently the focus of sanitation was the toilet, it meant that lots of toilets were built. But when those toilets were emptied, if there was no treatment site, then essentially you're just displacing this public health problem. So you're getting it out of your home and into the public domain where it can really create these much larger community public health crises. So in places like the United States, the government heavily subsidizes waste treatment and waste transport through the sewers. And at the same time, you know, we pay either a sewer connection fee or we pay a water bill. In the US and in many countries where there is very good sanitation coverage, it's this mixture of consumers paying a portion of it and then the government subsidizing it as well. And we very much see the future for good sanitation everywhere in the world needs to be that type of mixture where consumers have some level of choice and different alternatives that they can choose, and they do contribute and make that choice and they pay for that. But at the same time, the government needs to subsidize the waste treatment because that's a public good. And one of the really tricky things over the last few years in the sanitation sector is that it used to be seen as strictly a humanitarian sector in places where there was very poor sanitation coverage. And so nonprofits were just able to raise money and pay for toilets. And then when we started to really look at the lack of access around the world and how far we have to go before everyone has a toilet, it became clear that there's just not enough donor funds in the world to meet that need. And so people started thinking about, is there a way to introduce business principles? And is there a way to get consumers to pay for this service? And there was this huge wave of enthusiasm around, oh my goodness, maybe business is the answer. And maybe the private sector can solve all of these sanitation problems by just charging consumers. And so for a little while there, it was as if the bar was set much higher for countries living in poverty than it was for wealthier countries, in the sense that because in wealthier countries the subsidy exists, it means the government is paying a portion of that, whereas the enthusiasm about business solutions in more impoverished countries was about, can we get the consumers to pay the cost of everything? And I think people are now stepping back and saying, wait a minute, that is a very unfair bar to set. We really can't be saying to the most vulnerable communities in the world, you need to pay the full cost of a service that people in wealthier countries are not paying. So now I think it's scaling back a little bit, and the sanitation sector is saying this needs to be a mixed financing model, and we really need to find ways where consumers contribute, but the government also plays a role. And so now to come back to us as a nonprofit, and I mean, we're neither the private sector nor the public sector, so how do we fit into this? And we very much have seen our role as being a research and development organization. So being able to use donor money to take the risks that would be very challenging for a private entrepreneur to take on at this point. And certainly the case in Haiti is that the government simply doesn't have the financing to do this R&D. So we feel like as a nonprofit, we can test out different solutions, both technological and financial, and try to develop a model that we can then transfer to the private and public sectors in Haiti. So the bulk of our work has really been, how can we create a system that then can be replicated by others? So I would very much hope that, you know, 5-10 years down the line, it is not Soil that is actually implementing and providing sanitation in Haiti, but that we've provided the research base necessary for others to take that over.
Beautiful. So you're effectively running a pilot project now. And tell me about how far into the pilot you are, how long until you have some of these answers, and then maybe what's next? Have you already identified other communities that might be primed for a similar exploration in their context and bioregion?
Yeah. So where we are currently is that we have just over 1,000 families that are paying for this service. And we're at a point where we believe that the type of mixed financing model that we're looking at is one where that household service fee would cover the cost of building the toilet and doing that weekly collection within the neighborhood. And then the part of the service that would be funded through the public sector would actually be getting the collected waste from the neighborhood to the compost site, so that transport piece, the treatment of the waste, and the production of the compost. And in terms of creating a viable private business on the front end, we're getting there. I mean, we are between 80 and 90% cost recovery right now, so we have a little ways to go, and we very much hope and anticipate that we'll be at a point within the next 2 years where we'll have a model that could basically be like a business in a box, where we could say to a private entrepreneur, okay, you would like to develop this in your neighborhood. Here's how many households you're going to need to get to profitability. And here's the type of loan that you would need to get started. So that part we hope to be able to hand off in the next 2 to 3 years. And then the back end, this public part of transport, treatment, and reuse, I mean, on that end, through compost sales, we're probably recovering between 25 and 35% of our operating costs. So there the gap is much larger. And that's why we see there's going to be an ongoing need for either donor or public financing there. And I think the really exciting development over the last couple of months is that we've been working with a group of five other sanitation providers around the world who are all doing very similar work to ours. And we're calling it the Container-Based Sanitation Alliance. So the type of sanitation we're doing where instead of using sewers, you're using some sort of a sealable container is becoming, it was something that 5 years ago, no one was using this term, but I think now is really, it is becoming recognized among sanitation practitioners. And so through this Container-Based Sanitation Alliance, we've been able to attract the interest of big groups like the World Bank, the World Health Organization. And I just came back a week ago from a conference in Stockholm, Sweden, that was World Water Week. So it's one of the largest gatherings of water and sanitation practitioners around the world. And at that conference, there was a huge amount of focus on container-based sanitation. And I think that practitioners around the world are sort of struggling to come up with technologies that work in rapidly expanding urban areas because we can't keep up with sewers and we don't have enough water and pit latrines and other septic tanks tend to be unsafe in these areas. So there was a real void there. And I think that's where that enthusiasm is coming from. But the World Bank is just completing a study on container-based sanitation. And they did in-depth case studies with four of the six groups that are a part of this alliance. And so they started to talk about this study at World Water Week, and they'll release the final report in October. But I see this as a real turning point where, you know, all six of the different groups involved, we're all pretty small players. You know, none of us are at a very large scale now. And I think personally, I see the future of this technology as large utilities and corporations and groups like the World Bank and governments around the world really picking this up and them being the ones to bring it to scale. And so I think that this World Bank report looks like it's going to be very positive in terms of reporting on the cost effectiveness of container-based sanitation. And I think through that, it will generate a lot of government interest and hopefully some of the larger utilities around the world will get excited about trying it at scale. So We will continue to plug away at our work in Haiti and are very much committed to finding a sustainable sanitation solution that works for Haiti. But the ultimate goal is really to create something that can be replicable worldwide. And I think that we're at a turning point in terms of visibility within the sector. And also, we're getting to a point where that actually seems like it might be feasible. So I think it's an exciting time for the type of work we're doing.
Wonderful. Well, and I just want to express my gratitude and on the behalf of the team at Lyft, our gratitude for your commitment to solutions that are very small, that do stem from small, nimble, cost-effective, household scale, practical approaches to solving our environmental challenges. It seems that oftentimes, especially from these kind of macro international institutions, there's a leaning towards higher tech, more involved, more R&D heavy solutions. And I just want to appreciate you for really setting a high bar and setting a standard for us not to neglect the solutions that we have right at hand that as this hopefully this study will show and demonstrate that they are the most cost-effective ways to solve these challenges. Sasha, I'm wondering if you could share a bit about the six other alliance members and maybe their geographic regions and even the names so that our listeners can go and learn about them as well.
Oh, I'd love to. I really have learned so much from all of the different partners that we have. So the other groups are XRunner, which is based in Lima, Peru, Sanovation, which is in Naivasha, Kenya, Sanergy, who are based in Nairobi, Kenya, Clean Team, who are in Kumasi, Ghana, and Luwat, who are based in both the UK and also Madagascar.
Amazing. I will link to them. And that's also such, it's so apparent to me that you are an ecologist, because the pattern that you're taking in your approach to the systems shift is emerging around collaboration and starting with small and slow solutions. Can you talk a little bit about your background in ecology and how that's informed your work?
Thank you, Erin. I feel like that was a really nice, meaningful compliment. So I appreciate that. So as an ecologist, my area of focus was really nutrient cycling. And I was personally, and continue to be, very very enthusiastic about nitrogen. It's my favorite nutrient. So as a graduate student, I studied nitrogen cycling in agricultural ecosystems and looked at the different environmental impacts of organic and conventional fertilizers. And so at that time, I was not considering a career in sanitation, but I was working with poop. I was working with chicken poop then as an organic fertilizer. And I started to think about sanitation. So I went to Haiti in 2004 as a human rights observer. And I went at a very tumultuous political time, and there were a lot of very acute human rights abuses happening. But in spending time there, it really became clear that the most pervasive human rights abuse was poverty and all of the many symptoms of poverty. So in talking to people, what I kept hearing over and over again was this sort of list of challenges that people faced. And among them were malnutrition, not being able to access locally produced and affordable food, declining agricultural production, and sanitation, and all of the public health problems that come along with that. And so because I had fallen in love with Haiti and knew that I wanted to spend a significant part of my life there, I was really trying to think about how do you bring together these human rights issues with ecological systems. And about that time, I think I actually had a friend who wrote to me and said, I've read about this amazing thing that's happening in Zimbabwe with composting toilets and the recycling of human waste. And it was this very aha moment where I suddenly thought, these seemingly disparate problems are actually really linked to one another. I mean, they're all rooted in poverty, but is it possible to design solutions that can have a holistic and integrated approach to all of these different problems? And in learning about ecological sanitation and composting toilets, it just felt like this very elegant way to address both the sanitation and agricultural and environmental issues through a technology that is modeled after ecological systems. So it all just, it came together very nicely, and all of this sort of learning was in partnership with the communities that I've been working with in Haiti. So through my human rights work, I had the honor of really meeting a lot of amazing community activists. And so I was able to bounce these ideas off them and develop them together. And, people just love this idea of being able to have a solution that brought together these many different issues that people were struggling with. And I definitely think that was probably the most valuable part of my training as an ecologist, was really learning to see those connections.
Right. Ecology is the science of relationships. And love that. I love that story of how your journey into this. It's really inspiring. And I feel very kindred spirit sisterhood with you in that this is the vision of Lift Economy as well. Different context, but looking at how we can create livelihood-based solutions that are really addressing the kind of systemic relationships between all of the different needs that we have, and how our foods that we grow can have a regenerative impact on soils and communities. So very inspiring to talk with you and hear about how this work is manifesting in a different bioregion. Are there any ways that our listeners can support your work? What would you ask of our listeners, be it support in terms of learning more or actually on the ground support or donations, or how can they help?
Thanks for that question, Erin. Well, I think that, you know, certainly the first step to helping is familiarizing yourself with the problem and with the work that we're doing. So you can see a lot of this on our webpage, which is www.oursoil.org. And that's a place that you can go to get some information on both the problem and the solution. I think that we certainly, as I said, we are a research and development nonprofit, and we're trying to create livelihood opportunities in a sector that has traditionally been no margin, and even if we're very successful, is going to be a very low margin sector. I don't foresee anyone, nor do I necessarily think anyone should become a millionaire off of providing sanitation to vulnerable communities. But really, where we are right now, I mean, we have a 3 to 10 year timeline in front of us where we feel like we're still going to be putting these pieces of the puzzle together. And during that time, individual donations have made a huge difference for us in terms of keeping us afloat, but also allowing us to really respond dynamically to the needs of communities and also follow the path that our research leads us on. So one of the tricky things, we currently get most of our funding through institutional grants, and we have some great partners who support us with that. But often with these institutional grants, you're asked to sort of create a project over a given timeline and say what your activities are and what your outputs are going to be. And we do a lot of that, you know, but I think that it's very tricky, and this is my training as a scientist speaking. If you are truly doing research and you want to be responsible about responding to the outputs of that research and really changing your path based on what the outcomes are, then it's very hard to say, here's what we're going to be doing for the next 3 years in a responsible way, because what you do is based on what you find in your research. And so having individuals who support our work allows us to make responsible decisions about what course we take based on what those research outcomes are. And then another thing that individual donations are really important for, and are very close to my heart right now, is for responding to unanticipated emergencies. So we could have the most well-laid plans for this coming year, and something like Hurricane Irma can just completely disrupt those plans. So right now, you know, as we wait for news from Northern Haiti, we've said to our supporters, we're not raising money yet for emergency response. We want to see what the needs are, and then we will reach out in the case that we do need that. But unfortunately, the way that the world is heading, I think we're going to have a lot more of these unanticipated disasters. So being able to have a group of individual supporters who are familiar with our work, who trust us and who want to get to know us and form a relationship over the long term is absolutely critical to the success of this work. So I would certainly invite people to visit our webpage, to learn a bit more about us, to donate if you're able, and to come visit if you can. We do organize trips to come and see our work, and I think that there's nothing more impactful than being able to see it with your own eyes. So I certainly invite people to reach out through the website if you'd be interested in getting information on when we do these visits. And then I think the final thing is just for those of us living in places where we do have water flush toilets, I think that it's important to think about what that means to the environment. It's important to not just flush and forget, but to have some understanding of where that waste is going, of what the environmental costs and benefits of the current solutions that we have are, and then looking to pioneers who are trying new things. You know, there's a movement in California right now to move away from flush toilets. And, you know, it's very small pockets right now, but there are some really exciting innovations going on at that level. And we have some friends at the Occidental Arts and Ecology Center in California who I believe initially put us in touch with Lyft Economy. And they're doing some great work in the US looking at alternatives to water flush toilets. So one of the things we grapple with is, you know, is this solution that we're developing just a temporary solution until something better can be found? Or are we really working on something that is not only aspirational for right now, but it's really the wave of the future. And again, as an ecologist, I see us moving towards a future of water scarcity. And I think that all around the world, we're going to need to start thinking about new ways to run our sanitation systems. So for all of those engineers out there that might be listening, I hope that this will stimulate some thinking so that we can be coming up with alternative solutions, not only in places like Haiti, but all around the world.
Love that. And yes, we do love the work of the Oxon Arts and Ecology Center. I live just down the road from them. And apart from OAEC and the others in the coalition that you mentioned, who else are you looking at that's inspiring you with maybe their thought leadership or innovation? Are there any other books or people that you would recommend our listeners go to for further inspiration?
Well, my biggest inspiration, I think it's probably a little hard to find his work, although you can search for him. His name is Peter Morgan, and he is also a biologist who got into sanitation and has been in the sector for a fair amount of time now. I better not make a mistake, but definitely over 40 years. And he's living in Zimbabwe, and he actually won the World Water Prize 3 years ago, I believe, in Stockholm. So his work has been recognized, but he's very humble, and he calls himself a little backyard experimenter, and he really does experiment with everything in his backyard. But he got into sanitation because as a biologist, he was studying fly behavior, and he was working in Zimbabwe, and you know, when he would go in toilets, there were always so many flies, and he thought, well, I know that flies really like to fly towards the light, and this is a part of their behavior. So his initial invention was the ventilated pit latrine, so actually putting these vents on pit latrines, and then flies go, not only do smells go up through the vents, but flies fly towards that light at the top. And so he made this huge discovery in sanitation just based on his appreciation of animal behavior. And then since that time, he was the person who got me excited about ecological toilets and has been doing that work across Africa, but primarily in Zimbabwe for the last 40 years. So Peter Morgan, a wonderful human being and a great inspiration to me. Even if you don't find him splashed all over the internet, I think if you search his name, you'll find some really lovely things that he has written about ecological sanitation. So he's certainly my personal inspiration. And then I think it's really exciting to see the sanitation sector in general shifting to really think about waste as a resource. Instead of how do we treat this and get rid of it, we're thinking about how can we harvest those nutrients? How can we get that carbon out of the waste? How can we recycle the water that we do use in water-based systems? And so I think across the globe, there's a lot of this thinking going on right now. And you know, the Occidental Arts and Ecology Center are certainly a thought leader that I look to, but I feel like in general, it's becoming not so much of a fringe idea, but more of a mainstream approach to sanitation, to think about how can we get value out of these systems. And through that value, we're going to be creating more livelihood opportunities. So it's a wonderful time to be working in this sector. And I'm so pleased to see even engineers who 10 years ago would have said that's just ridiculous are now really thinking about ways that they can get engaged.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much for sharing this depth and breadth of wisdom with our listeners. Thank you so much for doing the hard work, not just on the ground of the activity of processing waste into this treasure, soil and services, but also of the really important social work that you're doing in terms of building coalitions and educating people around the globe. I'm just so appreciative of all that you do in service to these efforts, and so grateful we got to spend some time chatting about it today.
Thanks, Erin. Well, it was really my pleasure. I mean, it's so wonderful to be able to speak with groups that are doing sort of possibly working in a different sector, but really thinking with the same philosophy. And I knew that coming into this call that we would be coming from the same place, and that's only been reinforced over the last hour. So thank you.
Next Economy Now is a production of Lyft Economy. To listen to all of our episodes, go to lyfteconomy.com/podcast. That's lifteconomy.com/podcast. You can also sign up for our monthly newsletter at lifteconomy.com/newsletter. Please also rate and review our podcast on iTunes, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.